That spring, talk was everywhere of a new and faster way. In the bottom of Jacob Donner's saddlebag was a copy of Lansford Hastings' Emigrant's Guide, with its tantalizing talk of a faster route to the Garden of the Earth. The same day the Donners and the Reeds rolled west out of Springfield, Lansford Hastings prepared to head east from California to see what the shortcut he was promoting was really like.
He'd heard that you could go south of the lake. The idea was to depart just before you got to Fort Bridger, going through the Wasatch, south of the lake, across the Salt Desert, through the Rubies, into California. Problem was, he had never really done it, had never done it with a wagon, and yet it was his ambition to lead what people thought to be 7,000 wagons heading west that year, and Lansford Hastings was going to try and lead his share back.
Mr. Hastings, our pilot, is looking for some force from the States with which it is designed to revolutionize California. He's anxious to try this route, but my belief is that it is very little nearer and not so good a road as that by Fort Hall. James Clyman.
Independence, May 11th, 1846. My dearest only sister, I can give you no idea of the hurry of this place at this time. It is supposed there be 7,000 wagons this season. We go to California, to the Bay of San Francisco, a 4 months trip. I am willing to go, and have no doubt it will be an advantage to our children and to us. Farewell, my sister. You shall hear from me as soon as I have an opportunity. Tamsin Donner.
The Donners and the Reeds reached Independence, Missouri in the second week of May. Heavy spring rains had turned the unpaved streets to mud. Wagons bogged to the hubs. Drivers cursed and whipped the straining oxen. Immigrants hurried from store to store, purchasing supplies and anxiously inquiring after the latest news.
Singular as it may appear, there is as much electioneering here for the captaincy of this expedition as there is for the presidency of the United States. Edwin Bryant.
We have some of the best people in our company, and some, too, that are not so good. Tamsin Donner.
Day by day, week after week, wagons rolled out of Independence. Donners and the Reeds got started on May 12th.
Not a living or a moving object of any kind appears upon the face of the vast expanse. The white-topped wagons and the men and animals belonging to them are the only relief to the tomb-like stillness of the landscape. A lovelier scene was never gazed upon, nor one of more profound solitude.
A few days out, two riders overtook them. They brought mail from Independence and news that hostilities had broken out between the United States and Mexico on the Rio Grande. Each night, violent thunderstorms broke over the wagon train, scattering cattle and drenching the encampments. Each morning, the skies cleared, but the trail had turned to mud. The Reed's palace wagon had to be laboriously double-teamed over even moderate inclines, to the immense irritation of those forced to crawl along behind. On May 27th, the wagon train came to a standstill on the east bank of the Big Blue River, too swollen by rain to be forded. The company went into camp to build a makeshift ferry. By then, the journey had become too much for Margaret Reed's mother.
Grandma became speechless the day before she died. We made a neat coffin and buried her under a tree. We miss her very much. Every time we come into the wagon, we look at the bed for her, Virginia Reed.
On May 31st, 2 days after the burial of Sarah Keyes, the last of the wagons was ferried safely over the Big Blue.
June 16th. We are now on the Platte, 200 miles from Fort Laramie. I never could have believed we could have traveled so far with so little difficulty. Indeed, if I do not experience something far worse than I have yet done, I shall say the trouble is all in getting started. Tamsin Donner.
On June 27th, just 1 week behind schedule, the Donners and the Reeds reached Fort Laramie, an isolated trading post in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains. There, James Reed found an old friend from Illinois, a 54-year-old mountain man named James Clyman, who had just come east from California using Hastings Cutoff. We camped with them, Clyman remembered, and continued the conversation until a late hour. Reed, anxious to make up for lost time, asked Clyman what he thought of Hastings' new route.
I told him about the great desert and the roughness of the Sierras, and that a straight route might turn out to be impracticable. I told him to take the regular wagon track and never leave it. It is barely possible to get through if you follow it, and it may be impossible if you don't.
Clyman, who has just been south of the lake on horseback coming east with Lansford Hastings, says, don't do it. Don't do it, because you can't take wagons that way. Go the old route, be safe, you'll perish. And Reed says, there's a nigher route, and we might as well take it.
Why Reed didn't take the advice he got at Fort Laramie is, I don't know if there's an answer to that question. He was an intelligent man, decisive. I don't know. It's always, I guess, our insatiable desire to take a shortcut in life, thinking it'll get us there. And invariably it doesn't.
The next day, Clyman bid Reed goodbye and continued east, moving fast down the Platte. On July 15th, he crossed the Big Blue River and came to the grave of Margaret Reed's mother. For a long time, he stood looking down at the inscription, wondering what drove his countrymen west.
This stone shows us that all ages and all sects are found to undertake this long, tedious, and even dangerous journey for some unknown object, never to be realized even by those the most fortunate. And why? Because the human mind can never be satisfied, never at rest, always on the stretch for something new, some strange novelty.
Sarah Keyes had been a member of what would soon be called the Donner Party. She was the first to die. On July 17th, as the Reeds and the Donners toiled slowly up towards the Continental Divide, a lone horseman came riding down from South Pass, bearing an open letter from Lansford Hastings, addressed to all immigrants now on the road. It urged them to press on in one group to Fort Bridger, where Hastings himself would be waiting to escort them over the new trail. On July 18th, they crossed the Continental Divide. They were in what the mountain men called Oregon Country now, 1,000 miles from Independence, with more than 1,000 miles still to go. They moved on, spellbound by the altitude and the landscape and the endless sea of sage.
Once you got beyond Fort Laramie, there was no turning back. A lot of immigrants turned back by the time they got to Fort Laramie, realizing they were into something that they didn't want. But after that, you're pretty much committed all the way. Even though you might like to be able to, there's hardly a chance or opportunity. It just wouldn't work.
On July 20th, the wagon train reached the Little Sandy River. It was the parting of the ways. Most of the immigrants heeded James Clyman's warning and turned right. But 20 wagons, including the 9 belonging to the Donners and the Reeds, turned left towards Fort Bridger and the entrance to Hastings cut off. The next day, the new party met to elect a captain. James Reed was the obvious choice. But his aristocratic manner and his wealth had rubbed too many families the wrong way. They chose George Donner instead. One week later, the Donner party rolled into Fort Bridger, 2 log cabins and a corral run as a trading post by a celebrated mountain man named Jim Bridger. Lansford Hastings wasn't there. The promoter had started west a week earlier at the head of another group of wagons, leaving instructions for any emigrants who wished to follow along behind.